My name is Josh Wyner. I lead the College Excellence Program at the Aspen Institute. I'm here with a terrific panel of folks to talk about whether college should be free. Let me take a poll. How many people think college should be free? All right, we'll ask that again at the end. Diana Natalicio was unable to join us, so you're stuck with us four white guys. Gene Block, the chancellor of UCLA, former provost at the University of Virginia. Kevin Carey, the director of education policy at New America, and the author of a recent book, The End of College. You can tell us why college will end. If it ends, then who needs it to be free? And then Jamie Merisotis, the president and CEO of the Lumina Foundation, which is one of the biggest funders of higher education from the philanthropic side in the country. So we're here to talk about the college value, the value of college, and who bears the cost of college. And let's just dive right in. Let's start with the issue of college cost. Obviously, this has been in the news a lot lately. College costs are rising, debt loads are rising. And one of the questions is why that is. Why is college so expensive today, and why have the costs been rising? And Gene, you've been in the middle of very visible negotiations between the chancellor of the system, Janet Napolitano, and the governor of California. Talk a little bit about the state investment in higher ed and how that's had an impact on tuition at UCLA and across the state of California.
So, you know, for the last 20 years, California has been slowly disinvesting from public education. And it was most dramatic, obviously, after really, 2009. And for example, UCLA budget from the state dropped from, I think, about a $640 million to $399 million. So an extraordinary decrease, of course, driven by, the economy of the state. And, understandably, the state had to cut back dramatically. And we increased tuition to students. We call them fees. We don't call them tuition, but it's tuition from, I think, roughly $6,000 a year to $12,000 a year. That made up for a portion of the loss from state support. The rest of the loss from state support was made up by economies, and we stopped really hiring faculty. We stabilized our faculty, and it actually shrunk some, and increasing the number of international and out-of-state students that pay higher tuition. So in our case, probably the increase in tuition, at least over the last 5 to 10 years, has really been driven largely by disinvestment from the state. So I'd say the cost of education per student has really not gone up. It's really who's paying, and now families are paying more than the state's paying.
And students, as I understand it, don't really draw that distinction, right? I mean, they're protesting the fact that their tuition is going up.
That's right.
So say a little bit about the student response.
Yeah, so the demographics of our students are actually remarkable and something that makes us very proud in California. I think 36% of our students are on Pell Grants. About 50%, I think, qualify for full support. That is, they pay no fees. It's covered through a variety of grants, so they're fully covered, and that's because they're not from very wealthy families. But students reacted very badly to a proposed 5% increase in tuition for the forthcoming year, which will not occur because the governor and the president worked out an arrangement. But I think partly middle class families are being squeezed extremely hardly. They do not qualify for much financial support, and they've just seen their cost of their students' education rise and rise. So there's a really strong reaction from students, and we're mindful of that. I mean, I just don't think tuition costs can continue to rise. I mean, we've got to find ways to mitigate the cost of education, clearly.
Great. So this is, while we've had increases in government subsidies to higher ed or spending on higher ed in the past, we've really seen a decrease. It may be coming back a little bit. Kevin, in your book, you talk a little bit about the longer term reasons that higher ed costs may be going up. Say a little bit about your conclusions that you've drawn about costs and the hybrid university, as you describe it.
Sure. I think Gene's exactly right. There's no question that since 2008, the biggest reason that prices have been increasing at public institutions has been state disinvestment, although that varies an awful lot by state. California is worse than most states. Started in a better place, actually, so has kind of gone from being actually quite inexpensive to closer to the middle. But a huge increase nonetheless. However, it's, higher education prices have been rising for 30 years, closer to 35. So they go up more in economic downtimes, but they were going up when there wasn't a recession. They pretty much always go up. And they've also been rising substantially at private institutions, where, by definition, public disinvestment can't be the reason. Private institutions are, they're not entirely private, they actually are pretty highly reliant on federal financial aid, but federal financial aid is robust. You know, the federal government spends, when President Obama took office, you know, we spent $16, $17 billion a year on the federal Pell Grant program. That doubled to over $35 billion. And so there has not been a disinvestment in higher education at the federal level, far from it. So I think you have to kind of look at, there is a wider number of reasons, although public disinvestment is one of them. I think that colleges and universities are driven to become more expensive, and that a substantial amount of that cost is passed along to students, partly just because they're in a really favorable market. The value of college degrees, or you know, another way of putting it is the terrible consequences of not having a college degree, have certainly risen over time, and so colleges are just in a situation where a lot of people want what they're selling, and they have a lot of pricing power in the market. There is, at the upper end of the spectrum, clearly a race for prestige and status and kind of positional status competition between institutions that are trying to one-up one another in terms of recruiting professors and new research labs. There has been a growth in administrative spending in higher education. No offense to administrators. I'm sure your people do a great job. But there's, it's clearly the case that if you were to take, you know, a given university, look at it today, look at it 40 years ago, it's a lot nicer now. The physical plant has been heavily invested in, and there is a substantially more elaborate administrative infrastructure than there used to be. And so it's the combination of all these factors, race for prestige, public disinvestment, and institutions simply being in a position to be able to raise prices. I think when you put them all together, you get what we have now.
So with technology, you would expect that that could drive the cost down. And also, there's been a well-publicized move towards, away from full-time professors, tenured professors, towards adjuncts, which also should drive the cost down. Why have those not mitigated all of these other factors?
Well, technology drives cost down if you have easy market entry. And you don't have anything like that in American higher education. It is a very unusual sector in the sense that the vast majority of students in college now are enrolling at an institution that has existed for quite some time. We create very few new public or private nonprofit institutions, relatively speaking. So we kind of just have the institutions we have. It is a sort of a closed system. And so the institutions within it, to the extent that they have opportunities to become more productive and cut costs, and you know, you raised the issue of adjunct professors. We have been cutting costs of instruction for quite some time in terms of moving away from expensive tenure track professors to inexpensive adjunct faculty, but none of those cost savings have been absorbed into the system and just used to pay for other things. They have not resulted in a kind of corresponding downward pressure on prices, clearly.
So Jamie, by the way, how many people here have a college degree? Okay,
right.
Everybody. How many people here finished college where they started college? Okay, so that's virtually everybody in the room. Jamie, is that the picture that we see across the country? And I'm asking this because the mobility that we're seeing across institutional types and the loss of credits that is happening when students move from one institution to another may be one of the challenges in terms of the price going up.
Yeah,
How much of that is an issue?
I think that's right. So there's two issues, really. One is that there's inefficiencies in the system, right? And so a typical college student today actually attends two or more institutions before getting their first degree. So this is one element of where we talk about today's student. You know, this is not your father's higher education system. I say that because a generation ago, the vast majority of college attenders were men. Now they are women. There are lots of other factors associated with that. But in terms of the inefficiencies, credit transfer is one good example, one concrete example of the problem with the system. Students start at an institution, they try to go to the next institution. Some of the credits might transfer, some might not. It's a drag on the efficiency of the system. That slows down the processes. You've got other factors besides what Kevin was talking about in terms of higher student costs associated with things like student services, student mental health, lots of other things. Student health costs in general are much higher. And then you've got issues like the complexity of the financial aid process, the increasing demands for financial aid because, as Kevin points out, the three decades of tuition increases exceeding, actually doubling the rate of inflation for most of that 30-year period, I think has put a lot of pressure on families. But I think this issue of today's student being very different than the students of our generation has clouded the dialogue. One out of every five college students today attends a residential institution. So we spend a lot of time talking about students in those schools in the national dialogue. 80% are not enrolled, and we spend comparatively less talking about not just the students in the community colleges, which I think there's some good news here because they are getting a little more attention, but the vast majority of students in the public four-year institutions are not, in fact, living in residential housing on campus. And that clouds the picture of what the true costs are. It clouds the picture of what, in fact, people are reasonably able to pay. You know, it's worth pointing out, too, that in terms of today's student, they're older. The average college student is considerably older than she was a generation ago. Again, the majority of students are over the age of 22. A high number attend part-time. The list goes on. Today's students are a little more diverse, though equity is a very serious problem in our system. The good news is that we have made some strides there, and I think that adds to the dialogue in terms of who are we serving and what's the best way to serve them with the models that we have today.
Gene.
So I want to make a comment about transfers. So this is something that I think people don't realize. The UC system has a huge number of transfer students that enter in their third year. I think there were 15,000 students entered last year. And at UCLA, 40% of our third and fourth year students are transfer students. So we watch their progression pretty carefully to see whether they're having a problem transferring credits. And although it could be better, and we are improving on it, the time to graduation is proportionally the same as our students who start as freshmen. So in fact, it works successfully. I think California may be a best-in-class model for effective transfer between community colleges and four-year institutions.
Yeah, there are some state systems, California and Florida notably, that have created these pathways. But to put a finer point on it, data that you all probably are aware, 80% of students who enter community college say they want a bachelor's degree. Right? They're not there for a workforce credential. Now, many of them get one, and maybe they should be looking more in that direction for some of them. Only 17% have a bachelor's degree at the end of 6 years. And research is showing that this credit transfer issue, that the four-year college is not taking their credits, is an enormous impediment to their making their way. So California is really doing some work to try to solve that problem. So Jamie, you make the case that the traditional payers can't continue to absorb these price increases, that families and governments just aren't going to be able to absorb that. Say a little bit more about why you draw that conclusion.
Yeah, so we've been dealing with this rising tuition problem for these three decades, and here's how it's gone historically. So historically, we'd find ourselves in a time period where government would be constrained, so we'd put more pressure on the students and their families. We'd see these dramatic increases in tuitions, and there were lots of examples in recessionary time periods before the most recent recession, where we'd see these spikes in tuition of 20 or 30% in public institutions. They were not uncommon. In other times, we'd see the opposite, which is that we'd see more pressure the other way around. So one way or another, either we'd find ways for students to pay, we'd find ways for governments to pay. The problem now is both have very serious constraints, both the states and the federal government. It's worth emphasizing what Kevin said, which is that the federal government has stepped up to the plate here in the last few years and has significantly increased Pell Grant funding. But it shows you how far behind we were, that increase in government support still really hasn't gotten us anywhere close to where we were in terms of public support for higher education. So there's a long-term trend here of disinvestment at the federal level, disinvestment at the state level, and then the challenges of students and their families. So these constraints on students and families have put more and more of the pressure on them, right? Ultimately, they are the ones that are having to pay the price. And the net result, I think, has been interesting, which is that you're seeing more and more of this bifurcation in terms of enrollment. We're seeing more and more pressure on low-income, first-generation populations. They're the ones that are having some of the biggest problems. We're starting to see some of that creep into the middle class and other populations. But we're also starting to see more innovation coming out of the sector. I think there is some good news in terms of the changes in the delivery model, which is that we are taking greater risks, things like competency-based learning, efforts around trying to find ways to use more advanced techniques where you can actually help change the direction of the of the student coursework based on whether or not they've mastered the material. I think that's a potentially positive outcome of this highly negative environment of the higher tuition prices. Ultimately, though, here's the bottom line for me. We have a problem with affordability, and the problem with affordability really comes down to two things. The first is we're all in violent agreement that we want a more affordable system, but we don't have a definition of what that means. So if we say affordable, are we talking about lower prices? Are we talking about greater government investment? Or are we talking about affordable from the student perspective? And where this conversation about free, I think, gets very interesting is that I think we've got to be talking about affordability from the perspective of the student and his or her family. I think so much of what we talk about is actually on the cost side. It's on what the changes are in terms of tuitions and prices, and less on what can a student actually afford to pay. Here's a very simple measure to just give you one data point. So in 1971, a college student going to a public college in America could pay for that education in 1971 by working 10 hours per week in a part-time job. So they could pay for that college tuition by their earnings, roughly 500 hours per year in earnings. Today, that college student would have to work well over 8 hours a day, every single day of the year at minimum wage, in order to be able to afford that education. So from the student perspective, it really is a lot more expensive than it used to be. It really is an affordability problem. And I think that's the way we should be talking about affordability. What does it mean to the student and their family as compared to, I think, a lot of the conversations where we're talking about the affordability from the perspective of the institutions, affordability from the perspective of government. We've got to bring it down to the level of the individual.
So we'll come back to this question of free college in a moment, but I just want to, for a moment, talk a little bit about the consequences of the rising costs and the stagnant wages of middle-class families and poorer families in our country. So Jane, what do you see in California as the tuition's rising? What are the consequences of increasing tuition, the increasing price directly to students and families?
So for us, and we're very fortunate because we provide a lot of financial aid to low-income students. So for students with the lowest income, their tuition and fees are fully covered, and often much of their living costs are covered as well for many of them. It's really sort of the middle-class students that I think are especially getting squeezed. And what we're finding is that what it does is many of them are beginning to work part-time, and it slows down progression, it slows down their ability to fully participate in university life. So I'd say my sense of this is that the students that are most being impacted right now by increasing costs are our middle-class students. You know, we have students, the lower-income students. We have a California plan that families below, I think it's now $90,000 a year in family income, pay no fees. They're fully covered by grants. And then between 90 and 120, there's reduced fees. So it really is the families that in the middle class that are really being squeezed. And I think, you know, I think it's slowing them down in progression, although, again, our graduation rates, we're very fortunate, are still very high.
So clearly in California, it's a little bit of an aberration in that you've got the state support. In other places, you are still finding low-income families reporting that financial constraints are reasons that they're dropping out of college. So I think there are still challenges there. Kevin, you've looked into student debt and what's been happening with student debt in the country. Say a little bit about the intersection between the rising cost and rising levels of student debt.
Yeah, in 2003, I think, there was about $300 billion in outstanding student loan debt in the United States. Today, it's $1.2 trillion, 12 years later. And you know, some of that is population increase, and some of that is inflation. But one way or the other, even if we, and, you know, part of this conversation about the college affordability and you know, the distinction was made actually here yesterday between tuition price and net price, that's a fair distinction. But one way or the other, someone's borrowing a lot of money to go to college that wasn't borrowing a lot of money before. And I think, you know, it's important as we're talking about free higher education, and I was interested to see how many people in the audience raised their hands to your question at the beginning. This is not a discussion about some, like universal healthcare, getting to some place where we've never been before, and only, you know, the usual Nordic welfare states have ever gotten to. This is about a restoration of something that we had here in the United States for 30 or 40 years in terms of people being able to go to a public higher education institution, as Jamie said, not universally free for everyone, but affordable in a pretty authentic sense of the word affordable. Another debate we have in higher education policy circles is, well, how much debt is too much debt? There's certainly a very rational and reasonable way of thinking about taking on college debt as, like, quote, good debt. You're basically just borrowing against your future earnings to get the education that you need to have those earnings. And, you know, plenty of people borrow reasonable amounts of money to go to college, pay it back, and that turned out to be a good investment. But, I mean, two things about that. One, I think almost certainly the number of students who are taking on too much debt is rising. And given the fact that most undergraduates borrow now, and given the fact that there are millions of undergraduates, we're talking about a non-trivial number of people whose engagement with higher education is kind of catastrophic for them financially. You know, they're doing everything that they were told to do, making probably an unwise set of choices at a very young age when, you know, I think asking 17-year-old people to make wise long-term financial decisions is by definition a recipe for disaster. If that's what you're doing, things will not work out for large numbers of people, and they're not right now. And the third thing is, I think there's a sense of grievance, which is to say, hey, maybe I can pay back my $30,000 loan, but why do I have to? Like, my parents didn't have to. Their parents didn't have to. There's no reason to think the colleges are better now. Mm-hmm. There's just not any data to suggest that anyone is getting more back from their undergraduate education than they did before in terms of what they're learning. They might be making more money relative to non-graduates, but that's just the broader labor market. That's not anything colleges are doing. So it's changing the politics of higher education in an interesting way.
Yeah, so in fact, you might argue that they're getting less for their money. The evidence shows that students are spending less time studying, and that there's great inflation. What is the average number of A's in the country you cite in your book has gone up to 43% of all college grades.
I mean,
grades
the average grade's an A minus now.
The average grade's an A minus,
I mean,
but that's
I mean,
really
the statistics on this aren't fabulous, but there's one study that I think is pretty well put together using different data sources that concluded that in the 1960s, 1970s, full-time college students were working full-time as students. They were in class or studying 40 hours a week. And now it's like 25, 20. It's not as much.
Right. So one could argue
the Wobegon effect is real, right? 43% having an A is all the students are above average, apparently.
Yeah. Exactly.
Right.
Yeah. So Jamie, Lumina has set this goal, the Lumina Foundation. We now have just over 40% of Americans with a college credential, and Lumina has, looking at international comparisons and labor market demand, set a goal of 60% of Americans having a college credential by the year 2025. Say a little bit about what the intersection is between this rising debt load, rising cost of college, and attaining that goal in your mind.
Well, it's clearly, to state the obvious, it's an impediment to increasing attainment. Look, increasing attainment, I think, should be a shared objective. We see lots of states setting these goals. We see lots of communities, some of them in the room, like Louisville, setting very impressive goals in terms of their communities. I think that's a good starting point for the conversation because, in fact, the labor market demand is there. Two-thirds of the jobs being created today do require some form of post-high school education. We've got to get ourselves to that point. This is real. This is not some sort of abstract policy goal. But one of the biggest impediments, clearly, is this question of affordability. And I come back to this point that the affordability has got to be framed from the perspective of the student and the individual. What they are able to pay, I think, is a really relevant point here because they pay the consequences for the excessive debt, if there is excessive debt. They pay the consequences for the failure, for which, of course, there is a high rate of failure. About one out of every two college students drops out, doesn't actually get their degree. Finances and the researchers call social integration on campus are the two main reasons why students drop out of college, don't actually complete their degrees. So this issue of affordability and rising prices and the impact that it has on students and their families, I think is real and is a real impediment to increasing attainment. And I want to make one more sort of footnote point about this issue about debt. The reason why debt is such an interesting leading indicator is that I think it gets at some other questions for us. Whether or not $1.3 trillion is an aha moment for us or not is debatable for lots of reasons. It was always going to go up, at least in some ways you'd want it to go up because it shows a higher demand for education. I think in one way that's a good thing. Average debt loads are $28,000 per student. We hear a lot more about the students who borrow the $90,000 and $100,000. Average debt loads being $28,000 are higher than I think they should be, but I think there's an interesting debate about whether or not that is too high in general. But what's interesting about it is that what we're seeing, and there's some very good recent research from Demos, a very well-respected organization, that looked at borrowing rates for low-income and minority populations. And what they're showing is a surge in those in the borrowing for those populations. And in fact, for students in getting their associate degrees, African-American and low-income students actually have the highest debt level of associate degree graduates. Now think about that. That is a serious problem given the gaps we have in terms of attainment and what our society needs if, in fact, we're pushing more and more of the burden at the associate degree level on the African-American and low-income students. That's a warning sign, I think, that this system is not serving students the way it should, and that we need to be thinking hard about these questions of affordability.
So we have this conundrum, and we want to turn to solutions. This is the Ideas Festival, and a number of us have been at this for a long time, and we're not solving the problem, right? I mean, these incremental approaches to increasing Pell haven't solved the problem. We've got institutions where there are a lot of things that are driving costs forward. We've got governments that are constrained, and if you look out into the future, as Bob Templin, a senior fellow with our program, former college president, likes to say, the state is a deadbeat dad and he's not coming back, right? I mean, if you look at entitlement spending, it's gonna just absorb more and more. And you've got rising debt loads and a need for more higher education. So against this backdrop, we have Tennessee and the city of Chicago saying, let's make community college free. And the president proposing nationally, let's make the community college for those who start there the first 2 years of college free. Why isn't that the big idea that we should all be rallying behind rather than this incremental approach that we've taken in the past? Is that the solution, Gene?
Yeah, so I'm a big fan of President Obama's proposal. Not the details necessarily, but the concept. You know, we've had 12 years for free for a very long time, and nowadays when everyone requires more education, why not set the baseline for the country at 14 years? And it seemed like a very attractive way to begin a process of reducing the cost of college. Well, California community college costs are low to begin with. On the other hand, any help students can get with their fees and tuition, their Pell Grants can then be used for living costs, and maybe we can reduce the debt that some students are taking on by doing it. And I think it's time for us to make a bold commitment. Education's the future of this country, and I think this is the right path forward. I'm not sure the details of his plan are the right details, but the idea of saying, let's figure out a way to make the first 2 years of college, certainly community college, free for everyone.
Now, you said something there that I think it's important to focus on. You said that if you make tuition free, students can use their grants for other things. So the cost of, we're not talking necessarily about making the cost of going to college free. We're talking about tuition being free. Draw that distinction for us a little bit. What is the true cost of college and how does that compare to these proposals?
I mean, for students, even students at a community college, you know, they're a set of, they can't work full time anymore. If they want to make progression, they're going to have to reduce their work time. They have other expenses, the ability to cover their books and cover their transportation costs. And if they're living close to the college, cover their housing costs. That can make community college much more affordable. It's not, right now, even though it's the tuition may be very low, there's a lot of other costs associating with getting an education that add up, and therefore the students make very slow progress, some of them in community college.
So there is this question of how free is free, but to some extent this idea in Tennessee seems to have changed the dynamic a little bit. Kevin, say a little bit about what the difference between reality and perception might be and the idea of free college.
I mean, I think Gene is right. I think the attention given to President Obama's free community college proposal, the fact that this idea of free college or debt-free college seems to be resonating in the campaigns that are now being revved up in advance of the 2016 presidential election, it's all a good thing because it all comes from a good place. And again, it's this idea that we ought to expand our public commitments to education, given how important education is. I think people, given how complicated college is, you know, free is an uncomplicated concept. It's unambiguous. And so once you get beyond it, you don't know how far you're going to get beyond it. And so I think people are attracted to this sense of, yeah, if I do this and I do that, I will be able to get an education at no cost to myself. All of that said, however, I mean, California is an instructive example. Tuition in California community colleges, which is where most California undergraduates start by design, has always been close to free and is today. And so the consequence...
Well, what do you mean by that? Why is it free? Because you look on the website, it says it costs $2,000 for the tuition. Why is
that
you
can get a tuition waiver if you're a low-income student, and a lot of people do
Fair enough. Thanks. Community colleges.
And so now, living expenses are a different issue. And for a lot of community colleges, most of the cost of going to college, which is partly foregoing working, is keeping a roof over your head. And that's a real cost, and we need to think about that. But when the, you know, when the recession hit in 2008 and there were these huge across-the-board cuts to public higher education in California, because there's this strong political commitment in California to not raising tuition, what happened in the community colleges was fewer classes. And so we talk about access to higher education, and we think of access often, can I get into a college, will they accept me, and can I afford to pay tuition? In California community colleges, it was a third problem, which was, yeah, they will technically accept me, and I can afford to pay the tuition. There are no classes for me to pay tuition for. They're all closed. They couldn't. They didn't have enough money to hire all of the professors that they would need to teach these classes. So you would think after a recession, what ought to happen is there should be a counter-cyclical surge of people into the community college system because they're delaying going in the workforce or they're unemployed and they're coming back to get new skills. In fact, enrollment declined, I mean, by like hundreds of thousands of students. So all of which is to say it needs to be free good college. It needs to be free college where you actually get the classes you need, you can stay on track to graduate, and you learn something along the way. And my concern is that free college on the cheap sacrifices on the quality part of it, and then we really haven't helped people that much.
Well, this is one of the things that a lot of community college presidents and chancellors and system heads have raised, which is if we make it free, or what is the infrastructure? Do we have the infrastructure to absorb all of those students? And you're raising the possibility that, well, maybe you absorb them, but just simply admitting them and cashing their tuition checks doesn't mean that they get what they need. Jamie, your take on free college, free community college?
Yeah, so we're all in violent agreement about the value of the message, right? And I, the reason why I think the message is so important is that the conversation that we should be talking about is equity. That is, that we should be talking about how we narrow those gaps between low-income and high-income, between students of color and whites, between first generation and students whose parents went to college. And in that sense, the message is very powerful. But to underscore what Gene said, the devil really is in the details here. And there is a little bit of a cacophony right now in the efforts to create a simplified message, as Kevin said. So free has some consequences we should think about. Does free mean that we'd be subsidizing people who actually have the ability to pay? Is that what we want? Do we actually want more subsidies to go to higher income students? Is that an element of free? That's a complexity that I think we should talk about. Does free actually mean debt-free, which I think is a more interesting conversation, because I think that, in fact, debt-free may be something that you could actually achieve as a goal. Both free and debt-free are essentially outcomes, right? They're not really policies. The policies and the strategies, whether they're government policies or institutional policies, those are the kinds of things that add up towards getting to that point of free or being debt-free. And the Tennessee example being a very good one, what Tennessee figured out was that they could actually market this idea of free for not a lot of money in terms of state resources. They actually figured out how to add up the Pell Grants, the other support, in order to be able to make this concept of free relatively inexpensive for them from a state perspective. And I think one of the elements of the Tennessee program that deserves some credit here is that they've matched the free with a bunch of support services for students to help them navigate through the complexity of the system. I think that's another element here on the equity side that's really important to talk about. So, you know, I worry that free might send this message that, in fact, it is easier than it really is. And I want to raise one more point about free, and this may be an uncomfortable one, which is that as Americans, we perceive value based on price. And there's some famous research in higher education from the 1980s. We literally call this in higher education the Chivas-Regal effect, which is that we were willing to pay more because of the perceived value, that is, the outcomes, the quality of learning based on the price. Now, that is less true today than it may have been historically, but in fact, we perceive price with value. There's lots of examples of that. You all know the research about vodka as a consumer good and about the fact that consumers actually cannot tell the difference between a $35 bottle of vodka and an $8 bottle of vodka, but they will pay $35 because it says Grey Goose on it. And it's amazing what you're willing to pay for because of the perception of value. And I think, not to equate vodka with higher education, but I think that as Americans, we've got to grapple with this concept, with this idea that we equate outcomes and value with the price that we're paying, because I don't think that's right when it comes to higher education.
So I want to take us back. Obviously, that is called the Chivas Regal effect. It dates the research.
Yes, right, exactly.
Rather than, you know, it should be a single malt scotch.
Right. The Courvoisier effect.
Exactly, but I want to go back even further. So 1900, fewer than 10% of Americans are in high school. And we are the first country in the world to go to universal high school. For everybody, right? We didn't believe that everybody could go to high school. And my guess is that, did we have the Aspen Ideas Festival back then? I don't think so. But my guess is there were people sitting around. We may have. There were people sitting around talking about how, well, should we really be paying for high school for rich kids who are already going? They were talking about what the government investment, many of these sorts of details. But in fact, we made high school universal. And by World War II, the majority of Americans were going to high school. And if you read the research from the Harvard economists, Claudia Golden and Lawrence Katz, they document the enormous growth in the American economy that came from that investment in human capital. We know today that without at least 2 years of college, you're not going to be entering the middle class. Your chances of contributing to the economy go way down in a knowledge-based economy. Why not make that investment? Why isn't this exactly the same as it was 120 years ago, 115 years ago, where we know that we need more talent? We know that it's a public good. It's good for all of us. Why isn't this the same as free universal high school? And we don't draw these distinctions of consumer good or not. High school is for everybody, right?
I think Kevin hit on the point here, which is that a fundamental problem we have with our higher education system is that we cannot adequately articulate the value. We don't actually know what a college degree means. We do not have a common language for understanding what a college degree means. You get your bachelor's degree because you accumulated 120 credits. And the perception about whether or not your 120 credits are better than somebody else's is largely reputational. That's why things like U.S. News and World Report rankings do so well, because they're largely based on reputation, based on these sort of informal indicators. This movement in higher education to focus more on learning outcomes, I think, is very encouraging. But we really don't have a strong understanding about what degrees actually mean in terms of learning and what that means in terms of quality of life and quality of job outcomes. One more data point. I'm sorry, I feel like the data guy today. The Gallup Purdue Index, it was a very interesting piece of research that's being done every year now, started 2 years ago, that is the largest survey of alumni in the country. And essentially what they looked at was the question of what leads to great jobs and great lives, right? So Gallup's done this research now for 40 years on well-being and what personal well-being means, what workplace success actually looks like. And they asked people how that relates to their college education. Interestingly, there was no correlation in terms of the people who scored high on having a great life and a great job with where you went to college. Not Ivy League, not top 100 institution, not research university. None of those things mattered. There was no correlation with those. And I think that's something that we've got to grapple with as a country. What should a college degree actually mean? What does it represent in terms of learning? And how is that going to impact your quality of life and your success in the workplace? That, to me, is the big question facing American higher education.
So this issue of quality, I think, is important. Going back to 1900, people probably didn't know what quality meant in high school either, but we made that investment. Gene, what about that analogy?
So what strikes me, you know, thinking about when we decided to actually provide free high school to everybody, we didn't decide it was only, we would not allow it to be free for people that had means. I mean, it was for everybody. I'm not sure it wouldn't be smart to not so worry so much about whether a few wealthy people whose children go to community colleges shouldn't pay. I mean, I think maybe we should focus just everybody should be free for the first 14 years of education, of people going to community colleges. I don't think we can afford private colleges or four-year institutions, but we could certainly provide support for community colleges, which is really the core of the students who are now entering college, first-generation students. I mean, community colleges are filled with first-generation college students. So I would worry less about whether we're paying for a few students who have the means to go to a community college. Let's just make it, as we did with high school, it's universal for everyone.
Kevin, what about this analogy? And are there risks of making community college free?
Well, I mean, I guess I don't know that. Well, a few things. First of all, there are parts of the country where the community college infrastructure is very different. So again, California has a very well-built, has a extensive community college system. In other parts of the country, it's going to be an open access four-year institution that serves that role. So if we had, you know, the panelist who is missing today because she's ill, Dana Natalicio, who's the longtime president of University of Texas at El Paso, her student body population is very similar to the community college student body population in parts of California. I mean, UTEP is it's a research university, but it is an inexpensive, very affordable, fairly open access institution that serves an awful lot of first generation students, an awful lot of low income students. And so if we just say, if we make the free in 2 but not 4 year, well, just geographically, there'll be parts of the country where that won't work very well. And then again, I come back to this issue of quality. The California community college system is very well very built out. It is like fantastically dysfunctional if you spend any time paying attention to it. It's essentially ungoverned. It's run by local boards. The outcomes in many of the community college colleges are not good at all. It's absolutely the case that the students who make it through that system into the Cal State and the UC campuses do pretty well. Frankly, as all students who make it through the first 2 years of college tend to do in the third and fourth. And that's true in other community colleges, that's true in four-year institutions. But a ton of students never make it there in the first place. The point about the political commitment to the institution means you do have to pay for some of the people who could afford it otherwise, I think, is legitimate. High school is also kind of mandatory. High school students are not adults. We require them to go to high school in ways that we don't require people to go to college. There are also a lot of terrible high schools in America. I mean, one of the reasons a lot of people drop out of college is because they arrive in college without getting a very good high school education, because we are still working to make free access to good high schools a reality. The funding isn't there in a lot of places. We're working really hard to get college ready standards in place 100 years later, right? You know, and that's that's unfinished business. So it's important, but it's not nearly enough.
Great. Well, why don't we open it to the audience? But before we do, before you raise your hands for that, how many people still think college should be free? Oh, a few, I think. A couple fewer hands, I think. Anyway, questions right here? Wait for the mic, please, if you would. Thank you.
I really appreciate the panel this morning, and my son just graduated from UC Berkeley, so thank you for the wonderful California public system. However, the argument about paying for people who can afford it, certainly where I live in San Francisco and in New York, anybody who can afford it already will apply to private schools. And we haven't talked about private schools. And I would have appreciated hearing the perspective on your panel for somebody representing a private university, because I think that's a big part of the picture for people in higher income brackets. And these kids, if they can at all, in major metropolitan areas, are attending private schools and not going to the free high school and not going to the community college, by and large.
Gene, do you want to?
It's hard to be sympathetic with providing funds for students that are going to private institutions, at least high-cost private institutions. Though that's an interesting discussion. I mean, that gets back to the whole concept of a voucher, whether one should just give a student a certain amount of support. It'll fully pay for a community college, but it'll partially pay for a private institution. But my vision, at least the president's vision on this was community colleges, because it reaches such a large number of students who are first generation, moves a whole new families into the middle class. So I would have, I would be concerned about whether we provide support for students that have decided to go to private institutions.
Okay. Any other thoughts on this distinction between
public
and private?
It's an important one. No one is proposing free all college. So any proposal is going to be free public universities. And so that's a change. And that will probably upset a kind of balance or detente between the private and the private nonprofit and public sectors that has existed for 40-some years now. Private colleges aren't just for wealthy people. If you look at sort of who private colleges serve, they serve a whole range of incomes and a lot of middle class and not particularly wealthy students. And I think the private institutions that don't have a lot of money and don't serve people who have a lot of money are really, really struggling right now, including historically black institutions, most of which are private. A lot of smaller regional private institutions that particularly in the Northeast and Midwest are kind of part of our infrastructure. We rely on them to educate substantial numbers of students, and they don't seem to be part of this free conversation at all.
So about a quarter of students who are in higher ed, undergraduates, are in private institutions, both for-profit and nonprofit, mostly nonprofit, and then 75% in public. Here in the front, gentleman, the green sweater.
Hi, Ralph Wanger. I think that people don't value highly what is free. That's part of the problem with high schools. And I think it's very, second, governments don't have enough money to fund what the education system now, and asking them to fund colleges as well sounds very difficult, becomes an enormous new entitlement program. It will not be more efficient than the current system because no entitlement system has done that yet. And I think there are much better ways to handle things. I think one of the things is to put burden on alumni. People shouldn't borrow money to go to college. They should give equity to go to college. They should pay some percentage of their future incomes. And that's what essentially what the alumni system does now. So there are a lot of ways to finance college that would be more effective than the current system.
So let me just, two things. One is, look, government has long been a major payer of higher education in this country, both from a federal perspective, particularly since the Higher Education Act of 1965, and in terms of the state subsidies that go to support the operating costs of public colleges and universities. And the reason is that the public benefits of higher education are very high. That is, our collective well-being is shaped by individuals getting college degrees. There's lots and lots of evidence here that, in fact, our economy is stronger, our society is more stable, we have a greater appreciation for lots of things because of the public benefits that come from higher education. So I think the question is, where do the resources come from to support this enterprise? And I think it's a fair point to say, and as I mentioned, I think both government and individuals have a lot of constraints now. So one question is, are there other places to find resources? Alumni and individuals are not going to be able to provide enough resources to backfill what is clearly needed in terms of the system. So either we've got to find another source of revenue, which, by the way, is something we didn't talk about today, which is, what's the role of private capital markets in supporting higher education? That's a whole other conversation. Maybe it's another Aspen Ideas Fest conversation, but I think there's some interesting ideas there. Really, where the action is around the question of changing the delivery model. And this is where Kevin's book has been valuable, where places like UCLA have been very interesting, which is that we're starting to get to a different model of understanding that you can create high-quality learning opportunities not through the way we've always done it. That, in fact, you can use competency-based learning approaches. You can use these sophisticated advanced learning techniques. You can use technology in ways that we haven't done before to actually bring down the cost of production. So I think that's an important element, though Kevin has made the point, and I think he's right, that with all of the effort that we've got around changing the delivery model and improving the way in which we get to a more efficient system, we're still not 100% certain that that's going to bring the price down. We still don't have the evidence that, in fact, it will change the pricing behavior of the institutions, or in the cases where governments set prices, governments. That's a question that I think we've got to resolve.
So Jamie, you've used competency-based education a couple of times. Just briefly, can you describe the difference between a competency-based approach and the time?
Yeah, so the current system is essentially a credit hour is a time-based unit, right? So you get 3 hours per class, 120 credit hours, ta-da, you've got your bachelor's degree. In the current system, you know, time is essentially the constant and learning is the variable. In the competency-based learning models, of which there are many now, they've grown very rapidly, Western Governors University, Southern New Hampshire University, even lots of institutions that you know of are working with these models now. They actually articulate what a degree should mean based on the learning by defining the competencies or the proficiencies that people should have. And then your coursework is essentially designed to get you to the point where you can demonstrate the competency, where you can demonstrate the proficiency in that material. And the promise here is that, in fact, it increases the throughput, that it accelerates progress towards the degree, it brings down the cost of production because, in fact, you can demonstrate the competency without having to go through the time-based credit hour process, that, in fact, you may already know some of these things. You may already have those competencies. And so I think there's two benefits to the competency-based model. One is the efficiency. The other is on that question that I raised before, which is that it improves the likelihood that we can come to a common agreement about what a degree actually means. If we can articulate what those competencies are and agree a bachelor's degree is represented by these competencies, an associate degree is represented by those competencies, I think we would be in a much better position.
Great. Other questions in the back? Gentleman with the red hat.
Thank you very much. You just finally touched on something that I was hoping that the panel would discuss more or respond to, which is so much of the conversation about education in America defaults to the economic impacts of learning, and most of the discussion is about, as well internally, the economics of providing education. But you, I'm sorry, I forgot your name, but you mentioned just now the good for society of education. And so beyond the economic benefits of free education or higher education, would you please, all of you, sort of, you know, ponder that a little bit? What are some of the non-economic rationales for greater access to education?
So Gene, do you want to?
I agree. I mean, one of the things that's concerned me is that, you know, for a long time, and I think California, again, I'm proud, is a great model, is a public good because it serves the public to have better educated individuals. I mean, smarter voters. I mean, the issues that we deal with today are so sophisticated that how can someone actually make smart decisions with data that sometimes can be very confounding and conflicting? So I think that society benefits tremendously from having a more educated public. So there is a huge public benefit to more education. And you bring a very important point up.
Any other?
Yeah, absolutely. More educated citizens are better citizens. I feel like that's clearly true. Colleges and universities are also, they are both centers of education, but centers of knowledge production, and those things are related to one another, and they provide, they, you know, we rely on our colleges and universities to transmit our culture from one generation to the other. I mean, they're the institutions we have charged with that task. I do think, however, sometimes representatives of higher education are maybe a little too eager to define it in non-economic terms, even as they charge real American dollars for tuition. So you can't, you know, you can't pay your loan back in civic goodwill. You need a job to do that. And you know, frankly, if you talk to students and ask them, why are you going to college? Overwhelmingly, the answer is, so I can get a good job. Because people are not stupid, and they understand that there is basically no path to prosperity in this country right now that doesn't involve a good post-secondary credential. That's the reason our higher education system is as big and important as it is. It's one of the single biggest reasons that we provide all these subsidies to students. So it is a balance between the economic and the non-economic, but the economic is really important.
I think it's a healthy debate to have, right? So this issue of what do you want out of your college education, a great job and a great life, we should be talking about that. We should keep coming back to that point. And I think Kevin is right. In higher education, I think we've spent too much time emphasizing the great life and not enough about the great job. I still hear, unfortunately, too many college presidents saying, we don't train people for jobs, we train them for life. The reality is, what you should get out of your college education is both. And the irony might be that, in fact, the things that make you successful in work are what make you successful in life. So employers say, what do they want? They want critical thinkers, they want problem solvers, they want communicators, they want people who are ethical, they want people who can work well in teams. Well, that's part of what makes you successful in life. And finding the way to bridge that conversation so that, in fact, we can feel comfortable about saying great jobs are an acceptable outcome, but great lives should be equally as important, I think that's the kind of public dialogue we should be engaged in.
Terrific. Thanks. Right here with a blue shirt. Thank you.
Thank you. Would you talk a little bit about the impact of student debt on graduate work and the decision of students to go into and incur even more debt to become doctors and lawyers and college professors? And
I'd like to field that.
I mean, a lot of student debt is graduate debt. And when we say $1.2 trillion, graduate debt is a significant part of that. And in fact, the graduate debt part of the larger debt portfolio is growing faster, I think, than the undergraduate portfolio, so because it's not...
Graduate
and professional, professional, yeah. Because it's not limited. So the federal government puts pretty sharp limits on how much money will lend you to get a bachelor's degree or an associate's degree or a certificate. There are no limits on how much money, other than the tuition and your entire cost of living, to get a graduate degree. So this question of debt effects is an interesting one, and people have proposed that people are less likely to borrow to purchase homes or anything else that you would expect to borrow for if they have more debt coming out of undergraduate to begin with. My sense is that the research is not all that clear about the causality there. It's been kind of proposed more than proven, but logically it does make sense.
Yeah, one comment about this. So there's more and more research coming out that reveals the relative value of different degrees, both by discipline and by college. And one of the things that's emerging from that research is that in different disciplines, you need different levels of education. So a psychology degree, a bachelor's degree in psychology, standing alone doesn't have great labor market value. Combined with a graduate degree, it does. Engineering is the opposite. You see the value emerge with a bachelor's degree, and there are some places where you can get an IT, for instance, information technology, with a two-year credential, you can see great value. One of the challenges we have in terms of debt and cost is that we're not saying to students, here's the trajectory to value for you. It's through three institutions or one institution. It's through 2 years or 8 years. And when institutions help students make those decisions, by and large, they're saying, get this degree because it must have value. We're going to help you get as much debt as you need. So the institutional incentive is not very well aligned to the trajectory that students need. And you raise a really important point, which is that if you're counseling somebody who says, you know, I'm thinking of going into psychology versus another field that may have more value in that single degree, the colleges need to be aware of that, and students need to be aware of that. Because for many students, especially low-income students, the notion of 6 years of education, including a master's in social work, or whatever is needed after that bachelor's in psychology, that may be unrealistic. They need value to emerge earlier. They actually need to be able to earn a decent living and not go work at Starbucks after a four-year degree and never make it back. So I think as we start to understand the relative value of degrees by discipline, this question of graduate education and what the impact of cost is on that, I think starts to be differentiated and much more important.
A quick coda on this point. So the fuse on the debt bomb is the longest thing you would imagine. So we've been worried about, I was writing about this concern in the 1980s. In fact, there was research in the early 1980s, here's the canary in the coal mine, for students in law schools and in medical schools. The change in behavior between the students in their first year and when they graduated about whether they would go into public interest law, whether they would go into public health, was highly being influenced by the prospect of debt. So you fast forward that 30 years later, and the question is, do I really want to go to graduate school? What kind of graduate school program should I go into? What are the benefits that I would get out of it? What would I do with that graduate degree or professional degree in the case of law school and medical school? This has been an issue that we've seen coming down the tracks for years and years and years. And our inability to actually address it and deal with it, I think, is now confronting us. Now we have a serious problem, not just at that end of the pipeline, but in fact all the way through. And that's why we're having this national debate about debt, in my opinion.
The woman in the black jacket directly behind here. You had your hand up, yes.
Well, here's an audacious idea, maybe crazy. You know, we solved retirement by Social Security in this country. And what if, you know, you think about the countries that support college, universities, the government supports them, or a higher tax rate, income tax rate that supports college and universities. What if the United States developed something like Social Security that is automatically deducted from everybody's paycheck, and then people can supplement on their own voluntarily to support their children to go to a different level of college, for example, you know, liberal arts colleges that cost more or public institutions that cost less. So a crazy idea, but something that might be able to resolve some of the problems we're talking about. But after all, it is lack of political will to make college free.
So we haven't raised other countries here. Germany, college has been free or virtually free for a long time. If you look at a German university, it doesn't look like an American one. You don't have campuses and climbing walls and food services in the same way. And so it looks very different. But why not? I mean, what about this notion of going, why are we so different and why can't we just move to something that looks more like a European model?
I mean, Germany doesn't have particularly high college attainment rates either. So, so I mean, I think that's something to keep in mind. You know, the issues of class and opportunity, I think, come up in a proposal like the one that you put out there. Everyone gets who works gets Social Security, whereas everyone doesn't go to college. And college attendance is very implicated in class. And so to get a little bit to the point Jamie made, people who go to college are disproportionately well off. They are disproportionately the sons and daughters of people who went to college. So on some level, you know, a broad increased tax like Social Security that everyone pays on payroll, the benefits would be borne by only a limited number of people, not everyone who paid for it, and disproportionately people who already had a lot of resources. If you want to talk about, you know, a millionaire's tax or something like that to pay for higher education, I'm right there with you. but you know, the politics are different.
Other? Gene?
Well said.
Okay. I think we're out of time. I know there's another session coming in here at 11:40, but the panelists, I'm sure, would be happy to have a conversation out in the foyer. For those who didn't get their questions answered, join me in thanking them for...